I meant him no harm.
Keanu, I am sorry, but this is not your best movie. Though, to be fair, you probably weren't the one writing it. So The Day the Earth Stood Still is the name of two movies, one from 1951 and the 2008 remake. And I wanted to talk about why the 2008 remake is significantly more poorly written. But I also wanted to discuss why, and for that, cultural context is going to matter. So to open up the cultural state, in 1951, we are less than a decade out from World War II, and stuff. Focusing on how awesome it was we just killed Nazis, a lot of folk are a tad concerned about the fact that we now have bombs that can destroy entire cities at once, which you know is fair. It also renders the land uninhabitable. And nuclear energy is just starting to pop up and we don't know what that's going to lead to. So that's a big thing we care about. So much so that the movie ends with this speech, which I'm going to play in hopefully full.
The universe grows smaller every day, and the threat of aggression by any group anywhere can no longer be tolerated. There must be security for all, or no one is secure. Now, this does not mean giving up any freedom, except the freedom to act irresponsibly. Your ancestors knew this when they made laws to govern themselves and hired policemen to enforce them. We of the other planets have long accepted this principle. We have an organization for the mutual protection of all planets and for the complete elimination of aggression. The test of any such higher authority is, of course, the police force that supports it. For our policemen, we created a race of robots. Their function is to patrol the planets in spaceships like this one, and preserve the peace. In matters of aggression, we have given them absolute power over us. This power cannot be revoked. At the first sign of violence, they act automatically against the aggressor. The penalty for provoking their action is too terrible to risk. The result is, we live in peace, without arms or armies, secure in the knowledge that we are free from aggression and war. We do not pretend to have achieved perfection, but we do have a system, and it works. I came here to give you these facts. It is no concern of ours how you run your own planet, but if you threaten to extend your violence, this earth of yours will be reduced to a burned-out cinder. Your choice is simple. Join us and live in peace, or pursue your present course and face obliteration. We shall be waiting for your answer.
Now, it's important to understand that this is a core tenet of the movie, and as we go through them, I'll explain in more detail. But in 2008, despite the fact nukes have far surpassed their former state, it's been around 6 decades since the last active war usage, and the Cold War is wrapping up, so we're no longer as concerned about those. It's still concerning, we're just used to them. How you might be used to the possibility of a car crash, but you just don't think about it. Along with that, since technology's changed so much, unless we're gonna set the movie in 1950, the plot no longer makes full sense. So as a result, as the writers they hire, or maybe just the director, has to adapt it, they have to spend a minute and decide, how are we gonna change this to make it still a good movie? Now, they did this quite horribly, and I'll get to that. It's just worth acknowledging that if they changed nothing, the remake would have still been bad, or maybe even worse. So what do we worry about in 2008 enough that a movie about it should perform really well? Say it with me. Environmentalism. This is the same year WALL-E came out, so it was a topic doing well in theaters, and while I grew up with this feeling like a pretty distant concept, the people reading the news in 2008 might have found this New York Times article saying if we don't reverse the growth of greenhouse gas emissions by 2015, we would have a global climate disaster. And don't worry, I'm not going to be on a soapbox. The movie will do that for us. Otherwise, I wouldn't have brought that up. So with that context out of the way, let's start breaking down this movie. We open by meeting our protagonist, not the alien, but a microbiologist who will be replacing the housewife character from the 1950s version. Scientist nature is meant to allow for a more direct meeting to make sense, since the alien is not going to be seeking out people in this version of the story. After that, we are introduced to her son. The son is going to be a very important figure in this movie and was the emotional core of the original movie. We will be contrasting that as we get to it, but for now, just know that he's important. Our scientist is then picked up by the military and rushed to a UFO preparation site. The movie does a very solid job at presenting this as an emergency. If I can contrast a little, the original did this by showing the news reporting on it, but right here we get this nice up close personal series of events from a POV character, and it's very nice. Maybe even slightly better than the original. Skipping ahead slightly, we are shown the protagonist hiding a cell phone after being told that they aren't allowed in this area as a layer of caution to keep everything secret. Also establishes, unlike the original, the coming landing is unknown to the general population of the world, which will be built upon soon, with a scene in a conference room, where they learn they believe this is a meteor about to hit Manhattan in a dramatic 78 minutes. This puts our characters in some extreme pressure as they are told they are in charge of preparing for the aftermath.
The best we can do is to plan for the aftermath.
We are then shown our protagonist calling her son in the bathroom, holding back tears because she knows he will be lost in the collision. Then, a sudden knocking occurs, and we get this gem of an interaction.
Is that a cell phone? Can I borrow it?
All of this intro is golden storytelling that I would trade all of my meager wealth to match. It's done with every piece of dialogue being effective, it's tense, it shows humans reacting to death, and it helps us understand what's at stake to the individual characters. Unfortunately, the pat on the back I'm giving this show is about to end. We cut to the scientists on a helicopter over Manhattan discussing the impact that's about to occur. We are also told,
if they can't stop it before it hits, there will be nothing left but dust. It will sterilize the air.
We are then given a countdown where they brace for impact. And when they don't die, they are confused. But wait. There is a missing scene here. Why, I ask you, are they on a helicopter? That's right. Asteroid is seconds away from destroying this city entirely. Our logical and wise scientists jumped onto a flying machine, I assume just so they could watch. You know, a more responsible military might have placed the scientists in a bunker where they could receive live updates or just survive generally, but we went into the air around the impact zone where we aren't really any better off than on the ground, maybe even a little worse off. There isn't any tactical advantage to the helicopter. This is a blast that can sterilize the entire Earth. So what led to this? I assume it's a decision by the director so we can have this moment where they witness the alien land, which looks cool, but we've hopped over logic to make all this happen. The military and our protagonist then almost immediately surround the landing site because I guess having a small army of weaponry ready to deploy is exactly what I do around a doomed city. So they gather around and the alien steps out. I'd like to note this took 22 minutes to get to this point when the original took 10 minutes. It's not a huge deal. It might not even be a worse change. I just prefer stuff getting to the point. Suddenly, the alien is shot. This is done by an unknown soldier in both versions and is very dramatic. They lose a piece of the scene. The first movie, like I discussed before, involved matters of war. So when this shot was fired, it was representative of how you or I might reach for something defensively the second we're uncomfortable. On a national scale, this is whatever our best weapon at the time is, in this case a nuke, capable of destroying potentially the world as far as we are aware, making this scene symbolic of a wider point the movie was moving toward.
Also, check out this line I found in editing.
We have come to visit you in peace and with goodwill.
In addition to this, in the original, he has brought a device that was destroyed by the shot that would have...
It was a gift for your president. With this, he could have studied life on the other planets.
Once again, tying the symbolism by destroying something that could have been pretty neat. In our 2008, this visit is not tied to war, removing the symbolism from the shot, and the item is cut out because the plot has been altered to make bringing a gift illogical. Immediately after his shot in both versions, we are introduced to a robot of incredible power. In one version, making high-pitched noises, disabling the nearby soldiers, and in the other, making their weapons vanish into the air. Except for in this shot, where the old special effects are showing their age. I will take a moment to note the robot, at least in the introduction, is consistently more intimidating in the 2008 remake, and I liked it quite a bit. The next series of scenes are neat. I'll summarize it as the aliens get medical treatment. We are told that he is an alien species that has more or less inhabited a clone of some random dude who happens to be played by Keanu Reeves. The original had the idea that human form is just the most natural form for intelligent life, but here they changed it. It's a neutral change to the script. It doesn't actually ruin anything. Also, the protagonist gets a vial of goop that will be important later. Remember that vial of goop. Next, we are introduced to Government Lady. She will come up throughout the plot, but wasn't in the original, and we get our first 2008 conversation with the alien. I want to highlight how Lovecraftian I believe this one is.
What were you before you were human?
Different.
Different how?
It would only frighten you.
this won't play a role in the plot. I just kind of like the Lovecraftian nature. And then we get the biggest change. Reeves informs us there is a gathering of world leaders not far from here, and he will tell his purpose to them. Now, in the original, that speech at the end of the movie was his purpose for arriving at Earth at all. So he was very intent on gathering a bunch of world leaders. He ends up settling on a group of world-renowned scientists who will bring it back to their respective nations. Here, in 2008, and I'll have to skip ahead to explain why this is weird, he is planning on destroying humanity because they are killing the Earth.
He came to save the Earth from us.
He has no reason to explain his purpose to anyone, much less a gathering of the world leaders, and he knows it, going on to hide this information from the protagonist during the film. This change of motivation, which was to account for culture, leads to his actions through the film not making as much logical sense because his drive has been turned into kill all humans. Even starting right here, while laying in a crowded area, the only things we will see him do in the film as objectives is check on an informant to make sure destroying humanity is the right call, then plan to leave, which he doesn't end up doing for a bit. Landing in a crowded area where the military, which he's already shown as capable of destroying, can immediately nab you, doesn't check out unless you want to talk to them. Also, he says he will explain his purpose, but doesn't to any large group, making that line of dialogue just kind of an awkward inclusion of original dialogue for the twist that he plans to destroy everyone. And if he did at any point plan to explain his purpose, he has the capacity to do it on a worldwide level with the internet, no government intervention involved in this version of the movie, also part of why they changed the plot. After a little more back and forth, we cut to the government lady deciding what to do next. She says, and I quote, "History has lessons to teach us about first encounters. As a rule, the less advanced civilization is either exterminated or enslaved." Well, you guys heard it here first. She even cites two examples, Pizarro and the Incas, who, mind you, only conquered, according to the internet's research I could find, after a civil war and some diseases screwed over the Incas, and he had his hands full with frequent open rebellions before getting assassinated. Far from simple takeover of kill or enslave, I would argue. She also cites Columbus and the Native Americans, and while Columbus was a bit of a jerk, he didn't exterminate or even really enslave the primitive population. He pillaged and traded some military might for food, but are we really going to ignore the fact that Native Americans just kind of chilled well after Columbus's death, and they did a bunch of trading and other interaction with the settlers, sometimes going to war and winning in a lot of cases? Like Texas settlement, right? Indians were winning till we invented the six shooter. And even then, it wasn't like it was some one and done fight where we just immediately exterminated and enslaved them. The point where the Indians really got screwed over wasn't for a while, and even then, they weren't exterminated or enslaved. There's still a bunch of Native Americans here today. We did take over their territory, though. And she says the list goes on, but I highly doubt there are that many examples. Even with Africa, Europeans mostly just traded with the less advanced civilization. Granted, they traded for slaves, so it's a little closer to what she's citing, but it's not like they annihilated or enslaved. They traded. Most new interactions in history I've seen is, I wonder if we can trade. It's just straight up what I've seen. Maybe there's more cases. I don't know. And you know what? Let me show you a reverse example. Meet cargo cults. Less advanced civilizations who had a first encounter with a more advanced civilization as us, and we just kind of ignored it because we don't care about these guys, and now they make straw imitations of our epic tech. Sorry, that took a bit longer than I expected. Next, they are planning to drug and interrogate the alien, and the protagonist volunteers to administer a drug. Now, this next part confuses me quite a bit. She swaps the drug with water and tells the alien to run. So the simple question, and I think this is a very fair question, why? This is a very foreign entity that she hasn't been shown is worth preserving. I wouldn't take risks for it if they were all avoidable, but that's what I would do, not necessarily what the character would do. Put simply, I don't know why the character would do anything. Establishing motivations for the flow of plot is very important when you're writing. It explains why the characters do things, and the only motivation that we've been shown by her is her son. She puts herself and her ability to care for her son at extreme risk by interfering with the military. solitary, and she hasn't been established with an extreme wonder, an impulsive desire to help a sentient being, and none of this is established later. She simply makes a plot decision because the writers said so. In the 1950s version, the woman and child are introduced when,
"I think I should get out among your people. Become familiar with the basis for these strange, unreasoning attitudes."
So there isn't really a comparison to be made. This is a decision based on nothing. Keanu Reeves is then dragged into an interrogation room and escapes through the power of, I'm not really sure. The scene establishes his capacity to influence technology with just his mind. Somehow, he uses the same high-pitched frequency thingy the robot used to disable the base before leaving in a stylish stolen suit. Take note of the high-pitched frequency and the old one. His powers always involve getting back to his ship or simply knowing useful information. In fact, there's this one scene where we can see he doesn't have any sort of link. He grabs a flashlight and uses like a Morse code to communicate with the robot. But here, he just sprouts control of our technology, despite the fact we already established his body is human and no explanation for these abilities are ever given to us. And this wasn't even necessary for his escape. We already sort of had a blank insider that could let him go if we really needed it, but instead we just did interfering with the drugs. So he is out in the world now with the government trying to track him down. We are then shown he has blood on his chest and he falls over. So first, when did this wound happen? I think it wants to imply these stitches are from the bullet at the beginning, but we are about to be shown that those stitches can be healed by the goop, and that probably should have happened when he was covered in the goop. Anyway, he decides to ask some folks to call the protagonist so he can get his goop vial. So I have a few questions right here. Where did he get the phone number? How did he recover from suddenly falling on the floor? He's passed out and awake between cuts for no explanation. Is she the kind of character that would be taking a second massive self-imposed risk to pick him up with no plans? And with no answers, he is picked up and the party is together. Furthermore, how does he know that she has the goop with her and can bring it to him? Government was rather secretive about it. And to make it better, she brings her kid to pick up the man who the government is hunting. Why is any of this as it is? Too late, we already moved past this part of the script. Also, she asks if he is a friend to us, and he responds,
"I'm a friend to the Earth."
Intentionally concealing his actual plans. He uses the goop to heal the stitches he has. I already explained why that's dumb, but also the stitch thread just disappears, which isn't how those works. You have to cut them out. But that's pretty minor compared to the rest of this garbage, so let's keep moving. We get shown the robot doing things. It's not important at the moment. Okay, kid's turn to try and establish himself as a real character.
Why are people running? You should stay and fight.
Why? Because his father was in the military and died fighting, which is nice, I guess, but also he died fighting enemies, and this kid hasn't yet learned about Reeves' plan to wipe out humanity. Don't worry, he has a counter argument.
Well, we should kill him anyway, just to make sure.
So overall, not a huge deal, but we are establishing this kid is very anti-alien while not knowing there's an alien in his car. So they arrive at where Keanu was directing the car. They have a conversation and the protagonist asks, "Why did you come here?" To which he replied,
"I came to save the Earth."
An answer he was not willing to give earlier for no particular reason. But before we can ponder that, he meets with an old man. I want to say he's Chinese, might be Taiwan, might be any other Asian ethnicity. They speak to each other in Mandarin. We are told they have been out of contact for a long time, meaning I now want to know how Keanu knew to come here. And he responds with, "This is hostile territory," which I'm sorry, but no, it's not. You took the form of a human and they are not looking for you. This is about as neutral territory as you could find until the UFO showed up. Yeah, then asks if he can reason with humans in order to stop them from, not revealed at this point, but destroying the planet, to which he responds with, "No, humans are an unreasonable race," and I'm not exactly sure how he came to this conclusion. Maybe he found queer, but also he is well aware there is sentient thought present and there is already a pretty wide-scale environmental movement. Remember, this is the year WALL-E came out. All he would have probably had to do is talk to the world and go, "We're fixing this," or "I'm making you fix this," if he wants to have humans stop doing any of the bad environmental stuff. In fact, given his species nature, I bet they already have a high-tech fix they can just slap on the planet, no issues whatsoever. Unless a few extra clean energy generators is something aliens with space travel just don't have available to them. He also says that he has been among them for 70 years and they won't change, which, excuse me? But 70 years back from 2008 would have put you? Arriving during World War II. Living through the bounce back of the world after World War II. And then witnessing the Cold War and how we kind of forced ourselves to get along when in danger of mutually assured destruction.
And so both welcomed with open arms an easing of hostilities, otherwise known as détente. To improve relations, Nixon became the first U.S. president to visit Moscow in 1972, and Brezhnev returned the gesture a year later. A number of treaties were signed, including the 1972 SALT agreement that limited nuclear weapons. Relations with China were even improving via ping-pong diplomacy.
I would think, even ignoring the big events, seeing on an individual level every capacity for change in human nature. And he is saying that after living through the birth of the environmental movement, I get it if some aliens from the stars at a glance said the planet is dying, let's make a reset, but this is a 70-year operative who has been living among them, and that is just stupid. This is also the only extra step Keanu needed before wiping out the planet. I'd have thought you'd have two spies before wiping out a sentient race, but hey, what do I know? While we're here, why land in Manhattan? Why not ask this man what's up remotely? Or better yet, why ask to talk to the nations to explain your purpose at the beginning? And why not just give them a straight shot? Tell them, hey, this is what's up. Y'all mind fixing that? You got some time? If you don't fix it before this time, we're gonna wipe you out. Then, oh my goodness. Then Mandarin alien says,
this is my home now. I love them.
I love the humans. You idiot. You just signed a death sentence. You just tied a noose for the entirety of a population you have been with for 70 years and said, yeah, but I like them. Keep in mind, because this is obviously where the plot is heading, Keanu is going to be convinced to spare humanity by the end of the day. Something this guy, who lived among us for 70 years, wasn't convinced to do. So because Keanu is convinced, we know that this isn't just a matter of culture is different bullcrap. This guy's just dumb. Maybe he's senile. Maybe he's not ready for the human body to go senile. So then Keanu makes preparations to kill humanity by going to a forest and arriving at a space bubble party, and animals start crawling to the orb of power, which I'll skip forward and just show you the movie's explanation for it.
It's an arc. So are all the other spheres. They're saving as many species as they can.
He will be wiping out all living creatures and just needs himself a Halo-style replacement. It's not a big deal. Which I guess is fine. I just feel like an alien race could be a little more efficient about just destroying humans exclusively. You know, it seems like they could probably show up with an army of robots to do that if they so felt desired. Especially considering the destruction method, which we will get to, could probably be programmed to focus on a specific group. The child then gets moody and says, I'm going home, and runs out of the car. I'd make fun of him being dumb to think he could walk home, but this is something I think a kid actually might do. Also, he discovers that the guy is an alien and gets mad about it. He goes into the car, and the protagonist once again asks what's going on to the alien, and he finally reveals he is killing humanity. I think it's worth acknowledging his reasoning for one moment.
Can't risk the survival of this planet for the sake of one species. If the Earth dies, you die. If you die, the Earth survives. There are only a handful of planets in the cosmos that are capable of supporting complex life.
Which begs the question, if it's valuable for supporting complex life, why have you not touched Earth before now? It's not like you're seeking out a spot to colonize. It's just a planet you aren't involved with. Like, imagine if I was concerned with the well-being of Pluto's ecosystem, which somehow has life, to a point where I went through a 70-year plan just to determine if I need to kill a species for the survival of Pluto, but I had no intention of doing anything at all with Pluto as a space. I would also like to note the snap in attitude between cuts right here. It's a little funny.
You can't do this.
This one.
We can change.
And I'm sorry, Keanu, but this is an incredibly deadpan way to say, we are going to kill you. I'm stitching this with some John Wick dialogue just to show you guys the contrast in his acting range.
If you die, the Earth survives.
People keep asking if I'm back, and I haven't really had an answer. But now, yeah, I'm thinking I'm back. So you can either hand over your son, or you can die screaming alongside him!
Unfortunately, the hand of the author is very present as police just kind of show up at the most dramatically convenient time. Reeves then pulls a move by making the car back into the cop. Killing him instantly. So this is like a nice turning point if we want to just play the aliens as evil. Like, this would have been the perfect time to say we need to stop them and I don't know, find some bullcrap way to destroy the robot. It could have been awesome, but ignore that. That's not the point of this movie. Let's take a moment to assess what just happened. So first, his electricity power also screws with combustion engines to have it back up into him, which is an entirely mechanical process, not the same thing as your electric car. And second, speakers exist both on his car and the cop car. And we have established you have a very non-lethal takedown readily available to you that you have chosen to ignore. I do like how the child reacts. It's a very nice child reaction.
You killed him!
Love this little child actor. But then he uses the goop and the car to bring him back to life. Now keep in mind, he is killing humanity, so I think this resurrection is a bit of a wasted effort. But more than that, you can just do this? This is a very big power when it's not necessary for the rest of the plot. So at the very least, maybe we can have his motivation why. So what does he say when asked why?
He was an obstacle. I meant him no harm.
What? All the more reason to leave him dead. He was an obstacle. And it shouldn't matter to you either way. He's dead whether you resurrect him or not. He then claims he tried to speak with our leaders.
I tried to reason with you. I tried to speak with your leaders.
Which, no you did not. 1950s alien tried to speak with our leaders. And he spent the entire movie saying it up. Concluding by turning the power off to everything but air travels and hospitals all at once. Just to make sure he had everyone's intention when he spoke. And this was while he was dealing with 1950s tech. He wanted to speak with the leaders. You made a single request without even spending a moment to consider the worldwide communications network that you're vague. Powers could probably let you control on a whim. Protagonist lady then says, let me take you to one of our leaders so you can speak with him, and takes him to a scientist's house. A Nobel Prize winning scientist. But still, that is not a leader of humanity. This is a researcher of humanity. Mr. Beast, Markiplier, PewDiePie, these guys are closer to being leaders of humanity than this scientist is. But you know what? That's not even why we're here. We are here so we can lift the scene out of the 1950s movie, because apparently all those other scenes weren't necessary. But this one specifically, it's just core to the concept. So what he does is he fixes the scientist's board. It's already well established. We're not following the initial plot. So this decision to adhere to a random bit is a little arbitrary and odd. You're grabbing a scene and not watching for the substance, basically. See, the first one helping with the board was getting the attention of the scientist and assisting towards his goal of reaching the world. Right here? He just does it on a whim. Okay, cutting back to the robot buddy before returning to the main party, just sprinkling a little exposition, it's not important. So the kid watches a TV ad and chooses to call the military on the alien, which is in character, actually, and checks out from what we've been shown of this character so far. But keep in mind, we are very clearly establishing he hates aliens. Okay, scientist man again, he asks if there is tech to fix it, and he replies, the problem is not the technology, the problem is you lack the will to change. Excuse me, bro. There are levels of environmental concerns, but most of them can be solved with technology. Maybe you think there should be more nature reserves, in which case, you're actually already in a pretty good spot. Or maybe your issue is pollution, which can 100% be solved with more technology. Or maybe you think the problem is climate change caused by carbon emissions, which can also 100% be solved with more technology. And more accurately, the writers are hiding between a very vague mantra of humanity must change, refusing all elaboration, even though it seems like it's pretty fixable problems with super intelligent alien magic technology. We are given a little bit of backstory about the dude. It's not important. And the scientist proposes a theory.
You say we're on the brink of destruction, and you're right. But it's only on the brink that people find the will to change.
Which is a nice statement. You might even compare it to towards the end of the Cold War, when mutually assured destruction is why we bothered having some diplomatic relations. That's why we don't really do as many large-scale wars now, though there are some, it's normally between non-nuclear states. But in addition to that, Reeves has still made no actual effort to convince humanity to change. He's shown up, he set his goal, humanity's been like, we can change it, and he's like, no, you won't. So anyways, military shows up. I would think at this point I'd leave the child with the scientist so that he's safe. But they take him and run into the forest, because why not bring the child into potential death? During the chase, the child tries to get the military's attention and argues with his mother in an honestly really well-acted scene. I love these actors, except for Reeves, because he's very deadpan in this movie. Then a military man yo-yos down to grab her in an accidentally funny scene, leaving the child alone. Let me add some sound effects to that.
Jacob.
So what all is wrong here? I guess convenient timing, but that's not huge. My question is why grab the lady? You could have drawn a gun and captured both, or maybe even have a shot at capturing your active target. But nah, yo, keep the plot rolling. Reeves then executes the two fellows in a merciless helicopter crash. These guys don't get resurrection, and it displays him as cold and merciless. And this makes sense, because he was here to destroy humanity. Why would he waste time resurrecting someone? Heck, why would he have that power in the first place? The boy starts to run quite reasonably, and he chases. Why? Heck if I know. Let's see, right now his motivation is to destroy humanity, to save Earth's capacity to support life, to leave if he gets the opportunity, but he doesn't seem to mind either way. This child is doomed whether you follow him or not, but he might alert the military to your presence, so clearly you must be chasing him to destroy him, to finish him off. That's the only conclusion that could really logically be reached with your motivations and position. Otherwise, you would have just let him run. Nope, he's just saving people now. The child suddenly wants help getting home, and is down to take it from the alien. Now, y'all drove quite a while earlier, so clearly you can't just walk home, but...
This way.
Nope, we're just wandering off. I'm not entirely sure why or where the alien thinks they're going. And he follows, even though his one character trait has been thinking that the guy is a menace, even though he could still pretty easily go back to big scientist named House. Reeves, why are you giving the doomed child directions? You're a broken computer virus. You're supposed to destroy everything, and then you're choosing like one or two files to preserve to be destroyed later. Okay, we're back to the robot for a bit. Y'all, I like the robot. I like how intimidating it is compared to the original movie. Every time I see it, I can't wait to watch it exterminate humanity. It has some bugs. Now we're moving on. Protagonist says she wants to talk with the alien now that she is in the custody of military lady. We are then shown the briefest of scenes of the alien tolerating the little boy. Then back to the robot. The bugs are breaking through a driller's hazmat suit. The man panics, but they refuse to open the airlock. This movie has an anti-war message. This sacrifice would have been very meaningful. Sadly, we went for environmentalism. Shame, but here it's just showing the military is a bit cold. Then the robot dissolves into a swarm of bugs. Come on, man. He was so cool, and you turned him into a random swarm of locusts. We aren't going to get to watch him do lasers through cities. Bet you were expecting me to suddenly say the 50s were better, but no, they had lame special effects. Seeing the robot in its full glory was part of why I watched the movie this far. And you just swapped it with the cheaper to animate swarm? Why? I do, however, like this moment where the guy who ordered the death of the last fellow is prevented from leaving. Now that the second layer out has been hit with the swarm. Fun little cruel irony, but just give me a moment to mourn the death of my epic giant robot. In the arms of the angels, fly away with me. Okay, back to the movie. The swarm starts wrecking stuff that would have been cooler with a giant robot. So even if Alien changes his mind, he is already still responsible for more deaths than most mass shooters. And these ain't even self-defense deaths. These are innocent soldiers and a random truck driver and who knows how many random civilians that happen to be within a mile of this spot. This is the kick in the pants the government chick needs to let protagonists have her phone and freedom to try and persuade. So then we cut and Reeves and Son arrive at a building and go to check his phone, which doesn't work, which Reeves fixes because that's just a thing he can keep doing, allowing for a call conveniently right after the protagonist got her phone back, and they arrange a spot to meet each other back at the city. So Reeves and Son hitchhike a truck, and they have a second scene where they bond together. The boy apologizes to the alien and then asks what's going to happen to us, to which Reeves replies,
I was just wondering the same thing.
Pardon, sir? You were wondering? Are you not aware of what happens to species when you decide to exterminate them? I don't wonder what happens to the roaches in my house when I tint it. We know what's going to happen. You are well aware of what is up. Anyways, that marks scene two of these two having meaningful interactions. And they arrive at the meeting place. It's a graveyard. The boy reveals it's the graveyard where his dead father was buried and asks if Reeves can resurrect him. So this does a few things first. It establishes the goal that the boy set after seeing him do the resurrection. No, just kidding. He called the police after seeing the resurrection. So he must have set this goal between being saved and that phone call, which is kind of a convenient time to come up with a pretty random plan. Anyways, Reeves explains he can't do it because I guess long dead corpses are off limits. Once again, Keanu is playing it rather dully, but the child actor is killing it. I need to know what he's up to now. Well, anyways, so Keanu says something.
Nothing ever truly dies. The universe wastes nothing. Everything is simply transformed.
Which, if he buys, he wouldn't be making such a big deal out of saving humanity in a little while, but whatever. Anyways, protagonist is here. Keanu witnesses the protagonist and the child hugging, and I'm going to mark this as 30 scenes where Keanu and the boy sorta had the opportunity to bond. Reeves then says, "There is another side to you, I feel it now." Now, what I think is being referenced is humanity's willingness to care for other humans, or maybe perhaps he's referencing how the child was down to change regarding his opinions about aliens, proving humans can change. And Reeves is over here coming to this conclusion after 3 scenes with a random boy who hates him. If we may compare to 1950s Klaatu, who formed a bond with his child equivalent, and it wasn't even what the conclusion of the movie was about to bank on, let me just show you a small compilation of scenes of those two bonding.
Are you an FBI man?
No, I'm afraid not.
That's my father. He was killed at Anzio.
Did all those people die in wars?
Most of them. You don't seem to know much about anything, do you, Mr. Carpenter?
Well, I'll tell you, Bobby. I've been away a long time.
Don't they have places like this?
Well, they have cemeteries, but not like this one.
Bet they're worth $1,000,000.
Would you give me your $2 for 2 of these?
Well, sure. Okay.
He must have been a great man.
Well, sure. Mr. Carpenter, now can we go see the spaceship?
If you like.
What do you think makes it go?
Well, a highly developed form of atomic power, I should imagine.
I thought that was only for bombs.
No. No, it's for lots of other things, too.
And that's not even half of them, and it was still more than these two had. So they spot the swarm, and he confirms it's how humanity ends, and the mother asks if he can stop it. And we get the response, "I don't know, and you don't know, excuse me? This wasn't part of your training? This is your stuff, wise guy. You should know if there is an off switch." Anyways, it would, quote, "come at a price to your way of life." To which she responds, "but we can change, you know that now." To which I would say, does he? The only change of anything he's seen is the boy changing his mind about aliens. And that now has the pretext of him wanting something from the alien. That could have easily been a lie. No one else has even changed slightly in this entire movie. And he is applying this to the entire human race. That can probably change their way of life. He had a 70-year-old spy say they won't, and he changed his mind in 3 scenes. So we cut. Government lady is explaining on the phone that military action will make things worse, which she already realized they can't win a fight, so this scene kind of just wasted space. They run through a checkpoint because there isn't time and start an epic car chase. Honestly, while a little contrived, it mostly fits what we know. Let's just enjoy this beautiful action scene.
Bravo 1, we've got orders to let them through. Do you copy?
Roger that.
They're slowing down.
Why even include the checkpoint? Anyway, they arrive at the space orb, where the area has been cleared, then missiles. We're speedrunning the climax, there's just missiles now. The car flips over, driver man is dead, but don't worry, he wasn't named. The 3 characters we care about are fine. Also, Swarm is here now. Keanu yells, "we won't make it," and takes the party under a bridge. He says he's holding out the swarm, which I guess he can only do that from the cover of a bridge. And the child has bugs now and is dying. Much sad, very wow. Keanu removes them. Why have him dying in the first place? At least the movie's almost over. He brings up the professor's theory about how we change when in danger and then walks out into the storm, which he just said we won't make it less than a minute ago, and he stops all the bugs. Once again, imagine if they were cowering under the bridge hiding from a massive robot instead. Then we witness all the electricity, I assume, in the world turn off, so we will no longer harm the environment, saving humanity and preventing us from destroying the world at the same time, ending the movie in a somber state as you wonder how the world will respond to this dramatic change. Wait one moment. This was an option. This was a bloody option to spare humanity that was available from the very start. It didn't require anyone to change. It was a button. A button that you decided to press instead. Also, we are ignoring all the people he just doomed to horrible fates and confused death. Think about how many hospitals were just shut down, how many moving cars, how many moving planes are about to result in everyone dying, how many people who are now about to not be able to get life-saving medicine. And since we are still running on environmentalism, let's take a look at how much pollution he just dumped on the floor. That swarm was spreading across the world when this happened. I think the ending is supposed to be homage to how the biggest wonder in the first movie was turning off power in the world for 1 hour so that he could get everyone's attention, but that was carefully non-lethal.
As far as we can tell, all power's been cut off everywhere, with a few exceptions. And even these exceptions are remarkable. Hospitals, planes in flight, that sort of thing.
Here, as far as we know, it's permanent. So just to outline the ending, to make it real quick, humanity's change was never displayed despite all the central thesis, and it wasn't necessary. They killed their internal continuity, which makes the movie bad, not just when it compared against the original, but alone. If you watch this movie without the original, you could still come to my conclusion. I think there's still room in the world for a good adaptation. It just isn't this. Thank you for your time. This was a longer script than I'm used to filming, a full 6,200 words, when they normally are a little over 1,000. But I felt this was a great breakdown. Also, recording, this is like the third take that I've had to do, and I do these outside and it's summer. If this doesn't earn a subscribe, I don't know what will. I'm not looking forward to editing all this, and enjoy your day. Sorry, I forgot to add this. The 1951 version as of writing is on archive.org. It was free on YouTube but got removed from being free on YouTube, and the 2008 version is currently free on YouTube, just in case y'all want to watch them.